people with the road up, knock up and heritage. Hold race all the tale in the wood, in the midst of Carmel. Who dwell in the midst of Carmel? 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 Feed thy people with the rod of knock of the heritage. Who dwells all the tale in the wood, in the midst of Carmel? Who dwells 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 in the midst of Carmel?
Hebrews chapter 10, from verse 19 to 22. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us, through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. And having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. In Exodus chapter 19, the Bible said, don't draw nigh to the mountain where God descends. They are priests. They are called to be priests. They sanctified themselves. They set apart the days of sanctification. They could go to the foot of the mountain, but they cannot be drawn to the mountain. There is a word in the Bible for worshippers, comers. Especially in the book of Hebrews, you can read that word comers many times. They are comers closer to God, not to God himself. My dear brother, my dear sister, in the New Testament, in the passage we read, the Bible says in chapter 12, we have not come to Sinai, we have come to Sion. We have not come to Sinai, we have come to Sion. In Sion, the Lord says, or the Bible says, let us draw near to him. Let us draw near to him. Yesterday in our anointing prayer, the Lord spoke to the people the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And I was able to help them see what does it mean by testament. What's a testament? What a testament is? It is a will. It is something he has made available. So a provision he has made. Erpadu. My dear brother, my dear sister, in the world erpadu, the provision he has made, though they sanctified themselves, though they were comers, there are limitations. They cannot be fully come to the Lord. My dear brother, my dear sister, even the sanctified people, they could not draw nearer to the Lord. Don't come near. You'll be consumed. Because you would pollute the presence of God. Why they should not come nearer to God? They should not pollute the presence of God. My dear brother, my dear sister. So whatever the sanctification they could do, whatever the preparation they could do, even when they refrain from any sexual relationship with their husbands, with their wives, they are not fit enough to come into the very presence of God. My dear brother, my dear sister, with the revelation of Jesus Christ, we cannot pollute God. God delivers us from our defilement. In the Old Testament, one who touches a leper will be polluted, will be defiled. A Jew will not touch a leper. Even the father, mother, husband, wife, they may not touch a leper. They would become defiled. But Jesus touched a leper. He didn't become defiled. He made the defiled person clean. He made the defiled person clean. In the Old Testament, they don't touch a dead man. They don't touch a dead body. They don't touch a bear, a coffin, anything connected with death. Many years back, I was in a hospital in Adyar. I was near the reception desk. And there was a statue of their God. It was in the evening. Suddenly one pujari, a priest, came. He did some puja hurriedly and he started covering that statue. For the first time I saw that. He was covering that statue. I was very curious why all of a sudden he was totally covering that statue after that puja. So I asked somebody nearby, what was he doing? They said a patient must have been dead. This is the way they have to take the dead patient out. And when they are taking the dead patient out, that God should not see a dead patient. I'm not criticizing their hope. Even the Old Testament, the priest never wanted to touch a dead body. They thought it would defile that person. So they didn't want their God or that idol to see this dead body. Maybe they may have a reason for it. My dear brother, my dear sister, I'm not criticizing that religion, I'm just drawing a parallel. In Christianity, we see Jesus who touched dead man, who touched the daughter of Jairus, the girl who was dead. He touched the bear of the young man, of the widow of Nain. As a Jew, he must have got defiled. But that touch didn't make him defiled. But he was able to give life to the dead people. In some holy places, they say a girl who attained puberty should not come there. Probably women after 60, those who got a menopause, they can come. But women, maybe those who attained puberty until they got the days of womanhood, they should not come to that mountain. It's their faith. Nothing wrong in it. Even the Old Testament, those women cannot go to the synagogue, to the temple. In the days of that womanhood, they are considered to be defiled. They don't want this woman to come near to him. They didn't want him to go to that mountain. The Malaik Varakuda, the women should not come to that mountain. Only young girls who haven't attained the puberty and old women can come to the mountain. It was not new. It didn't belong to that religion. It belonged to the Bible. God said, don't come to that mountain. Don't come to that mountain. It's in the Bible. But a woman, not 3 days in a month, not a week in a month, 12 long years suffered from hemorrhage, bleeding. 12 long years suffered from bleeding. Jesus didn't say, don't come near. She touched Jesus. She touched Jesus. There is a vast difference between the Old Testament and the religions of the world and Christianity. In the Old Testament, don't come near to the mountain. In the New Testament, come to the mountain. Come to the most holy place. So in Hebrews chapter 10 verse 19, Because of this, having therefore, brethren, having therefore boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. In their religion, they cannot go to that mountain. An unholy person cannot go to their holy place. Somebody told me, according to the Muslim religion, only one who is with no sin and one who can sin no more should go to Hajj. We cannot take anything that would pollute the sins. Only one who can say, I have no sin, and one who would sin no more can go to that holy place. If anything unholy cannot go into that place, we cannot imagine that an unholy man can go to that place. My dear brother, my dear sister. But because of the provision, because of the New Testament, having therefore boldness to enter into the holiest, it is by the blood of Jesus, by a new and a living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say his flesh, because Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. When his side was ripped open, he made a new way, a living way, to get into the Holy of Holies, the holiest sanctum. He has made a new way. The religion doesn't give that permission. Jewish religion doesn't give that permission. For that matter, any other religion doesn't give the provision. You cannot go. You cannot go nearer to that place. You will be stoned to death. Or they will shoot an arrow at you. They won't come and touch you. They'll throw a stone and kill you. Or they will shoot an arrow at you or a spear. They won't touch you because you are defiled. With a stone or with an arrow, with a spear only they'll kill you. They won't come and touch you. But now we have got the boldness. Because of the death of Jesus on the cross of Calvary and because of his blood, he has made a new testament, a new provision, a new ஏற்பாடு. நமக்கு ஒரு ஏற்பாடு பண்ணியிருக்கிறார். What is that ஏற்பாடு? Now you can come boldly. As you are, without any plea, you come boldly. My dear brother, my dear sister, not only because of that, verse 21, chapter 10, Hebrews. And having an high priest over the house of God, that was high priest. He won't permit you to go into the, even to the court, or probably to the holy place, to the holy of holies. No, you can't go. But we have got a high priest who can understand us. A high priest over the house of God. Because of that, let us draw near unto him. A Christian life, a Christian walk, is not based on the doctrines, it's based on drawing closer to God. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is a way of living. Christianity is a way of living. Christianity is following Christ. Christianity is imitating Christ. There's no religion in it. If at all we take religious aspect, there are only two things mandatory in Christianity which Jesus himself constituted. No church, no church leader. One is a baptism. That is following Jesus. The other day I was talking to a person who seemed to be an intellectual giant. When I was talking to him, he said, I want to follow Jesus, but I don't want to become a Christian. I said, even Jesus was not a Christian. No, no, I don't want to be a Christian. I said, yes, sir, even Jesus was not a Christian. Why should you become a Christian? Third time he said, no, no, I mean I don't want to become a Christian. I said, I am also not a Christian. He didn't know how to make me understand. He knew that I understood, but he didn't know how to make me wake up. Then he came to plain terms. No, no, I mean I want to follow Jesus, but not taking this baptism and all. I said, Jesus was baptized. If you want to follow Jesus, take the first step, getting baptized. You can't follow Jesus without taking baptism. I said, baptism is not a religious, but don't see baptism in a religious connotation. Baptism is your first step in following Jesus. And there's only one more sacrament, that's the Lord's Supper. That is also what Jesus constituted, and he showed that to the disciple and said, do likewise, follow it. Other than that Christianity, we don't have any religious thing. He said, I don't want to give up my culture. I said, what's your culture, tell me? What's your culture that you should not... No, no, our own... I said, what's your culture? No, no, I am a Hindu, I can't give up my culture. I said, sir, what's your culture, you tell me? That you can't give up. What's your culture? Getting up early in the morning, is it against Christianity? Should you give it up? Because you become a Christian? Praying 3 times or 5 times, 7 times, is it your culture? Because they are becoming a Christian, should you give it up? Wearing a dhoti is your culture. Is it mandatory that you should not wear a dhoti if you become a Christian? What is your culture that you should give up? No, you have to do puja to the idols. And I said, Deba, it's not your culture. The saints say, don't worship the idols. The Hindu sages have said, don't worship the idols. And in Christianity, there are many people who worship the pictures. They keep the pictures, they keep the dolls, idols. They keep the cross. So it is wrong in Christianity, it is wrong in Hinduism. We need not give up anything. It is not a cultural change. Because he became a Christian, it's not necessary that he should change from sari to pants. Because you are a Christian, it's not necessary that you must have girlfriends. Because you became a Christian, it's not necessary that you should attend pubs because you became a Christian. In what way Christianity can be against our culture? When we can define what culture is, that's the second question. My dear brother, my dear sister, all religions will stop people coming closer to God. All religions, they can go up to the temple with a pure heart, with a sincere heart. They can take coconut. They can break coconut in the presence of God. They can go round and round and round of the sanctum, the holiest shrine. They can go 7 times, they can go 14 times, they can go 3 times, round and round. You cannot go in. Your religion stops going into the most holy place, Moolasthanam, you can't go. It's not only Hindu religion, any religion, but only Christianity, because of the death of Jesus Christ, he says, come closer. But when we draw closer, he gives us spiritual principles which will not stop. There, nothing would permit them to go closer. You can't do anything to go closer. You can't do anything to go closer. Here you can have the boldness to come closer, but he gives you a caution. Just 4 things. We read in verse 22. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Number one, let us draw near with a true heart. A heart is very, very important. So he starts from inside. When the Lord is building up the tabernacle, the Lord started from inside, the most holy place, the Ark of Covenant, then the holy place, the furniture in the holy place. Then he came to the court, then to the gate. But when Moses was constructing the tabernacle, he started from outside. When we see a person from outside. I see his body, I see his dress. When we mix with him, I will understand his mind, his likes, his dislikes, his emotions, his wants. When I become still closer, I talk with him, live with him, move with him, eat with him, spend more time with him, I understand his spirit. This fellow has got a spirit of anger. This fellow has got a spirit of fear. So when I interact with a person, I start with his body, with his dress. Then I understand his mind. Then I understand his spirit. The Lord starts from inside. So when we want to draw closer to the Lord, we must have a true heart. Does it mean that we should not have an artificial heart? Here it means we should have a sincere heart. A heart that is totally dedicated to the Lord. A heart that is 100% only to the Lord. A girl gave her photograph to her boyfriend. This boyfriend wanted to enlarge that photograph to have a good frame and wanted to keep it. So very dutifully he gave that photograph to a professional to work on it and to get a frame for that. The professional just turned back and saw something written on that. It is written, "Dear, I love you very much. My heart is only 100% only to you and to you alone. In case you don't accept my offer, please return this photograph. Somebody is waiting." It was a big shock to the shop owner. "My heart is only for you. And if you don't accept this offer, somebody is waiting." My dear brother, my dear sister, can we say that our heart, we have got a sincere heart towards the Lord? Lord, you and you alone. There's nothing I withhold from you. There's no secret in my heart. There is no area that I don't permit to you. There is no reservation in my heart. 100% I am for you. He says, just draw near to him with a sincere heart. To understand this passage, I quickly read, "That I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. I have espoused you, I have engaged you, betrothed you. I espoused you to one husband, not to many husbands. I espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety." I fear lest by any means your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ, from your sincerity that is in Christ, for your sincere love to Christ. It is not Christ plus. Suppose if a woman says, or a girl says, tells her husband, "I love you very much, but it's not only you in my heart. In my heart, it's you plus. You plus." She's not sincere. It is not that we should go away with somebody else. But in our heart, if we give room for something else to the love of the world. James 4:4, "You adulterer and adulteresses, the love of the world is enmity to God." Suppose a woman loves a man who hates her husband. What do we call that woman? Oswald J. Smith asked this big question. In a world, if a woman loves the enemy of her husband, what do we call that woman? The same name applicable to the persons, to the believers, who love the enemy of Jesus, the world. Jesus said, "The world hated me. The world hated me." And you are the bride of Jesus, wife of Jesus, betrothed to Jesus. And you love the world that hated Jesus. It's a spiritual adultery. You don't have a true heart. My dear brother, my dear sister. So when we draw closer to the Lord, the first thing, the foremost thing that we require, it is the true heart. A heart filled with love. It's not a religion. It's a way of living. It is bearing your heart to the heart of the Lord. He's not in the white sari. He's not in the white jubba. He's not in the white suit. He's not in a cassock. It's not in the vestment. There's a religion. You want to wear a good white sari or white suit or jibba, it's nice. The Bible doesn't say that those who want to serve me wear only white suit. The Bible doesn't say those who want to serve me only be in jibba dhoti. That is good. But what is required? A heart that is sincere to the Lord. A heart that is sincere to the Lord. So to draw closer to Him, this heart is very, very important. Heart is filled with perversions. It's very difficult to control our heart. The more and more we fill with Jesus, our hearts are true to Jesus. Number two, with the full assurance of faith. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. Last week, I told you the difference between assurance and confidence. Assurance is the antonym of self-confidence. Assurance is based on something somebody has assured. Assurance is based on something somebody has assured. Last week I read to you a few definitions of what assurance is. We had a message on blessed assurance. And at that time we read Hebrews chapter 10 verse 22. The full assurance of faith. Assurance signifies the joyous, unwavering confidence of an intelligent faith. It's not self-confidence. It's a joyous, unwavering confidence of an intelligent faith, not a blind faith. It signifies a joyous, unwavering confidence born out of an intelligent faith. Assurance is the security of fearless trust. With no fear, I trust somebody. I don't have any doubt. I got no fear. I trust that person. And what is the amount of the security of that trust? Am I secured? Or somebody can hack it. Is this secured? Is this relationship secured? Is this transaction secured? In the cyber world, there's nothing secured. There's nothing secured. They put it as secured transaction. Even a secure transaction is not in Pentagon. Somebody is able to hack the files in Pentagon. You trust somebody with no fear, fearless trust. But is that secure? You trusted that woman and said everything to her. But it's a secured confidence. She becomes the real cause to spread that news. You told somebody, only to you I'm saying. I'm not telling anybody. Even my husband doesn't know. Only to you I'm saying. A very good friend. She goes and tells only one more person. There also she says, she told me not to tell anybody. I'm telling you only to you. I'm not telling anybody else. Within half an hour it will reach you back. My dear brother, my dear, is that trust secure? But assurance is the security of a fearless trust. Assurance is the soul's apprehension of its complete emancipation from the power of evil and from consequent judgment through the atoning grace of Christ. Because of the atoning grace of Christ, my soul has apprehended, my soul has taken hold of, apprehension, taking hold of. My soul has apprehended its complete emancipation. Emancipation means deliverance, liberty. My soul has apprehended its complete deliverance, liberty, emancipation from the power of evil. How could my soul find this emancipation? Because of assurance. Because of assurance. How do I get this assurance? Because of the atoning power of Jesus' grace. Not only my soul has found deliverance from evil and from consequent judgment of that evil. All liars will go to hell. Now I got an assurance. I got deliverance from evil and the consequent judgment of that evil. How do I get the deliverance? My soul has got an intelligent faith. Faith on what? Because of the death of Jesus Christ, the atoning grace. It gives me a type of an assurance that all my evils are forgiven. So when you draw closer to God, not only a true heart, an assurance that your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. In those days before baptism, they would make this confession a mandatory. They have to give a testimony in the church. All my sins are forgiven and I am cleansed by the blood of Jesus. At the time that I make a covenant with the Lord, I must have the assurance that His blood has washed away all my sins. Nowadays, the truth is not lost. In many places, not practiced very heavily. But it is a must. You must have the assurance that your sins are forgiven. You must have the assurance that you are delivered from the clutches of sin. You must have assurance that you are made righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. You must have the assurance that all your sins are forgiven and you are justified, acquitted. There is no sin against you. You must have that assurance before you take baptism. So even in the New Testament you can draw closer to the Lord. For that you can't do any ceremony. And in every religion signifies that no ceremony can allow you to come closer to God. My dear brother, my dear sister, no breaking of coconut can allow you to come closer into the holiest place. Your religion can't do it. Jews sacrifice, they can bring an animal to sacrifice, but they can come only up to the court. They can't go to the holiest place. No religion allows people to go to the holiest place. So here with a true heart, number two, with the assurance of faith, my sins are forgiven. If I don't have that assurance, I cannot come closer to the most holy place, brother, sister. That's very, very important. So what is this assurance? That's why I said it is the exact opposite of self-confidence. Being a joyous appropriation and experience of the fullness of Christ, a glad sense of security, freedom, and eternal life in Him. You must have that assurance. If I die, I will go to heaven. A preacher was conducting a prayer meeting for a Christian old lady who passed away. A son-in-law was a drunkard, one who can drink like a fish. So because mommy has prayer meeting, The swimmer had come. When the preacher spotted him there in the crowd, the preacher's heart was moved towards him. Somehow, at least on this day, this fellow should get saved. Because his mother-in-law always had a concern for his drunkard son-in-law, alcoholic son-in-law. So when the service was over, this preacher went straight to him and he said, "Brother, you drink like this. If you die today, where will you go?" With no hesitation, with no second thought, that fellow said spontaneously, "Satyama narakathukku poven." What a confidence it was. He has got the assurance that he will go to hell. You ask a Christian, "If you die today, where will you go?" "I want to go to heaven. I know Jesus died for me. I'm praying every day that I should go to heaven. I go to church and I pay my tithe. I want to go to heaven. Even I keep Udubati to my Jesus pictures." I have done that. We had a lovely rose garden in our house. The rose plant was up to this height, about 5 feet. Every day we can have Edward roses in it. All big roses. And my sisters, they don't pluck those roses to keep it on their head. When I was growing up, I was a very nice fellow. Every day I will pluck one rose and keep it in Jesus' picture. Because I'm keeping it in Jesus' picture, my parents never scolded me. Because I'm keeping it only in Jesus' picture. We want to do all these things to go to heaven. He said, "I will do all these things." But who knows? Only God knows. That drunkard had an assurance, "Chetta satyama narakathukku poven." Many believers don't have the assurance that they will have eternal life. I love to sing the songs about eternity, about heaven. When we had this night before my wedding, that bachelor's time, so all people came. And probably that's the time they want to cheer up the bachelor, because in a few hours he's going to end up his bachelor freedom. The other day one man was sporting with a beard. I said, "Why are you sporting with a beard?" He said, "I'm going to soon give up my bachelorhood." I said, "Don't worry, I tell the people to stop the wedding." "Huh? Why should you worry that you're going to lose your bachelorhood?" So in that evening, my sister asked me, "Tell me a song that you love very much." I said, "Sweet By and By." No, any other song. "Jerusalem, My Sweet Home." Not a Savupata Solra. For them, it's not Savupat. My dear brother, my dear sister. Here in our church, many times we sing this song. Once we were singing that song in our United service, "Beulah Land, Oh Sweet Beulah Land." That time one sister came and told me, "Pastor, the partlam pada dinga partna bayamma irukku." In the partlam partna bayamma irukku. I always say, when I'm kept in coffin, somebody stand around and sing this song, in what way that would help me? They cannot sing these songs and send me to heaven. My dear brother, my dear sister, we must have the full assurance. Assurance about our sins forgiven. Assurance about a holy life. Assurance about eternal life. We can come closer. No religion stops us. No religious practices stops us. But we must have the full assurance of it. "I believe there is an eternity. I believe He prepares a mansion for me. I believe that He would come and take me. I believe that when I die, I leave this body to be with Him in heaven." That is the full assurance of faith. We cannot draw closer to Him. We cannot go into that holy place without this assurance of faith. I can go on and on. My dear brother, my dear sister. Number three. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. God is certainly above our conscience. But our conscience should not prick us. Because our conscience doesn't prick us, it doesn't mean that we are perfect. God is above our conscience. Probably the conscience of an Israelite may not prick him. Maybe the conscience of a soldier may not prick him when he shoots at his enemy. Because his conscience doesn't prick him, it doesn't mean that he is perfect. God is above our conscience. But, if our conscience itself pricks us, then who can help us? You can never lie to your conscience. You can lie to anybody. You can lie to your husband. You can lie to your parents. You can lie to your wife. You can lie to your children. You can lie to the teacher. Even you can lie to the police. I don't know how many of you know it. At times, the investigating officers, they use these lie detector tests. But in the court of law, the results of those lie detecting tests are not accepted. Because if a man can have a strong willpower, even during a lie detecting test, he can lie. He can lie. A man cannot lie only two people. One is he cannot lie to God, a personality. You cannot lie to God. Okay, whether you believe in God or not, leave it. Nobody can lie to himself or herself if he or she is a sane person. I don't know about insane people. If you know it, I understand you. I don't know about insane people. A sane person can never lie to himself. It's impossible. You are seeing some porn program in your computer. Your mommy asks, "What's that you saw?" No, just a general program. You can erase the history. You can even take it from hard disk. You can destroy any evidence. But can you erase it from your conscience? Nothing can deliver us from our conscience. The worst enemy of a man is his guilty conscience. Probably a man can brand his conscience with a hot iron. He can smear his conscience with a hot iron. He can make his conscience dead. But never he can make a light his conscience. Guilty conscience, the worst enemy. Wherever you go, your conscience will go with you. Your conscience will go with you. Where can you run from your conscience? You go to the depth of the sea, your conscience will be with you. You climb to the top of a mountain, your conscience will be with you. You take the wings of an eagle and soar sky, your conscience will soar with you. My dear brother, my dear sister, Hebrews 9:9 says, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. You did something wrong. He offered sacrifices. 2 bullocks. You robbed somebody. So the law said, I sacrifice 3 bullocks. Six lamb you offered. You may know God has forgiven you. You may know you have acquitted from that sin. But can your conscience say that you didn't lie? So those sacrifices, it very clearly says, could not make him that did the service perfect. Could not make him that did offer those animals perfect, pertaining to the conscience. They say to be delivered from this sin, or for this curse not to follow you. You murdered somebody. You have to break at least 100 coconuts. 1,000 coconuts. But can you stop that blood crying against you? Can that cleanse you from your conscience? My dear brother, my dear sister. Verse 14, Hebrew 9. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Son offered himself without a spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? So when the blood applied, our conscience is cleansed to serve the living God. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is not that I have forgotten I murdered somebody. I cannot forget it. But my conscience is purged from the guilt of it. I was a worse sinner. The Lord has forgiven me. Jesus died on the cross. He has delivered me from that sin. It's not that I have forgotten that I was a sinner. Paul says he was a chief sinner. And he became a chief apostle. He could serve the Lord. He was serving the Lord, serving the people whom he persecuted. He was serving the people whom you persecuted. He was toiling, laboring, without resting on the world, for what he wanted to once destroy. He was toiling, laboring to build the kingdom of God, which he wanted to destroy earlier. The blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse our conscience. Earlier, one of our believers brought his friend to me for prayer. He said that person has already all of a sudden developed a suicidal tendency. He's become insane. You always want to commit suicide. The Spirit of led me to talk to him alone. So I told that friend, I want to talk to him alone. Can you leave him aside here for some time? So when this believer left, I was spending time with him. Then he came out with this problem. He had a very good friend. They were sharing one purse. They were sharing one plate. They were always together. They went to movie together. That friend got married. He said, except his wife, nothing he kept away from me. But one day when my friend was not there, I committed sin with his wife. Nobody knew. The girl was not minding about it. But I know I have done a treacherous thing against my friend. I cannot tell him. It's not a sin involving only with me. I can tell him otherwise. But now it involves his wife. He loves his wife very much. I don't want to say a wife has done this. But I could not talk with him. I could not walk with him. I'm not fit to live on this world anymore. I gave him my Bible and asked him to read Hebrews 9:14. There is only one provision to purge your conscience from dead works that you could live to serve him. My dear brother, my dear sister. So let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. Number 4. And our bodies washed with pure water. In most of the religions, it's a practice to wash their bodies. In Jewish religion, before they go to their worship, a comer, he has to wash his hands and his feet. They wash their hands and feet many times. Before every prayer, they wash their hands and their feet. Without having a wash, a devout Hindu will not go to a puja. They will bath before they do pujas. Before they do their namaz, even the mosque, there will be bathtubs where they wash their legs, their feet, hands, face. They go to namaz. Many years back, a sister who was a senior nurse in a reputed hospital. They are very close with us when we were in AC. Almost daily they would come to our house. Their daughter is very fond of her sister. One day they are giving us their testimony how they came into Christ. It was a very big shock. That sister told me, we are from a very orthodox Hindu family. We have got a lot of customs. We cannot go to the kitchen without bath. Only because of all these things we became Christians. Only that day I knew, some people think in Christianity cleanliness is not necessary. This body wash is in every religion. So you go to a mosque, you can see there are a lot of bathtubs, washtubs, where they have to sit, wash their feet and all with water. So in the Jewish religion, when somebody touched a dead body or defiled in one way or the other, with the pure water, the water that was kept in the sanctuary, water mingled with the blood of a sacrificed beast, with that water he should be purified. In the New Testament there's no temple worship. I said there's no religion. But he says, your bodies washed with pure water. Your bodies are washed with pure water. My dear brother, my dear sister, where we are living in earlier, in Molakadai, we have got a wonderful water which I have never seen in my life. If you are bathed in that water without a treatment, your color will change. Even with a treatment, when I wash my inner garments, I love to use only white. But I got a type of a reddish brown inner garments. Can we say that's a pure water? And we talk about mineral water, bottled water, packaged water. Can we say that that's a pure water? They say that water is very hazardous. It has got a lot of insecticides, poisons. Somebody said they take the water from Kuvam and some silver nitrate or some insecticides. They bottle it and bring it. I don't know how much it is true. Can we say our corporation, our metro water is a pure water? But the Bible says, when you want to draw closer to Him, wash your bodies with pure water. In our redemption, in our salvation, spirit, soul and body are important. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23 we read, our spirit, soul and body must be kept perfect when He comes. It's not only the holiness of spirit and soul, even our body must be holy to the Lord. Our bodies are very important. I told you about an intellectual person who was discussing with me the other day. Then he came about the dress. He said, some people, they are not holy inside. Only outside they put on white and all. I said, they are hypocrites. I don't worry how I am outside. I must be holy inside. I said, you are also a hypocrite. No, not that. I want to be holy inside. I don't mind how I am outside. I said, you are a hypocrite. He got puzzled. I said, somebody unholy inside, holy outside is a hypocrite. Somebody holy inside, outside unholy, he is also a hypocrite. Somebody holy inside and holy outside, he is genuine. That's right. Everything else is a deception. You say that you are holy inside and outside you want to show unholy. It's a deception. That's a hypocrisy. You are not what you are showing. You should be holy inside. You should be holy outside. Our bodies are important. But how can we wash our bodies with pure water? Is that baptism? But when we draw closer to Him, we understand that we must have a true heart, we must have the full assurance of faith, and we must have a conscience void of any offense. But how can I wash my body with pure water, with water I should have a wash? In a village scene, an actress in a village pump set, we all love that. I don't know how many of you had that experience. There will be a big tank, the pump set, the water will come in a full force. We all jump in the tank and bath. Anybody here? Pump set bath? Only I can see two or three hands. Wonderful experience. With full force. I love that. More than having a bath in a falls. So there was a scene. The actress was to bath in a pump set. She said, no, I will do it only with the mineral water. I don't do it with an ordinary water. Why? See, I do my business with my body. I can't spoil my body. I do only with mineral water. Can you think that mineral water is pure? What is a pure water that can wash my body? My dear brother, my dear sister, that pure water is the Word of God. That pure water is the Word of God. Not only your spirit and soul, your body must be also washed with the Word of God. How we should adorn ourselves, how we should not adorn ourselves, what is a must for us, what is a must that we should not have it. We must know the Word of God. The Word of God must have washed our bodies also. When I die, I must have this assurance that my body is the temple of God. God dwells in my body, not just in my mind, not just in my spirit, not just in my soul. He lives in my body. He walks with me. He talks with me. He moves in my body. My body is the temple of God. The body of a believer is different from the body of an unbeliever. The spirit that quickened Jesus from the dead dwells in our mortal body. The spirit that quickens us from the dead dwells in our mortal body. My dear brother, my dear sister, we must have our bodies different. Our bodies will be quickened. Those who are dead in Christ will rise first. Those who are alive and remain in Him without seeing death, our bodies will be transformed. For a believer, the holiness of a body is also very, very important. It's not a religion. It's not a religion. It's not a religious mandatory. If it is a religious mandatory that somebody should remove jewels, then all Christians must have removed jewels. Baptism, as I said earlier, may have a religious connotation, but that's also following Christ. But in every Christianity, in one way or the other, baptism is mandatory. But bodily holiness is not a religion. Removing ornaments is not a religion. Then everybody must remove it. Here, washing our body with the word of God. We want to fashion ourselves. We want to adorn ourselves. We want to decorate ourselves. We want to dress ourselves as it is in the Bible, fashioned by the Bible, for the glory of God. I want to keep my body as the temple of God. I want to glorify my body, my God in my body. Not a religion. How should I dress? I must know. I just not to exhibit my contours of my body. I dress to cover my body with all decency. Whether it's a sari or pants, the purpose what I wear is to cover or to exhibit, is to keep my eye, protect me from other evil eyes, or to become a prey, to become a food for lustful eyes. What I do? When I stand before the mirror to dress up, what's in my mind? That I should be a center of attraction. They should see my back, they should see my front, they should see my legs. They should know how slim I am. Why I dress? I want to cover my body. I want to protect myself from the lustful, evil, ravenous eyes of some evil men or women. We must know. Wash your bodies with the word of God. With the word of God. That's not religion. If it's a religion, I can say you must have a type of a dress that could cover you from head to toe. That must be in black in color. You must cover your hair. Only your eyes must see. I can give a dress code. This is not a religion. This is your lifestyle. Your lifestyle doesn't glorify God. Or does it signify the evil in us? Does my lifestyle glorify God? Or does my lifestyle signifies the evil in me? You can't say, as I told that man the other day, you can't say, I'm holy inside, I'm not worried about outside. You are a hypocrite. You are a pretender. You are deceiving. You are holy inside. You want to show outside as anybody in the world. Why can't you show to the world that you are a God's child? Nothing wrong in it. Nothing wrong in it. When you are holy inside, be holy outside. Have the fashion of godliness, not the fashion of the worldliness. Both are in the Bible. The fashions of the world pass away. Not conforming to the world. Transforming according to the renewing of mind. Not conforming to the fashions of the world, but transforming to the renewing of mind. So when we draw closer to the Lord, four things, very essential. Number one, a sincere heart to the Lord. Otherwise, why should we come closer to Him? Number two, assurance of faith. Jesus is mine. Number three, a clean conscience, void of offense. Number four, a body that is washed with pure water, that is the Word of God. Draw me nearer, nearer to Thee. To the cross where Thou hast died, draw me nearer, nearer to the bleeding side. Let us draw near to Him. Shall we pray? Dear Father God, we thank You, we praise You for these words, O Lord. Would You abide in my heart to speak to Your people? Bless Your people with these words. Help us have a Christian lifestyle whereby we can draw boldly to You, to Your heart. Bless Your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.